For the first half of the show, I got to say this. If you feel like there's been a tug on your heart, if you feel like the whole, we were praying that the Holy Spirit will be magnified in this show, that the Holy Spirit would touch your heart. If you're feeling that, that's not weird. That's not strange. It truly is an answer to our prayers. And you can always go to www.abnsat.com and put in your prayer requests, put in your questions. This show is about you receiving a real touch from Jesus, who desires nothing more than to be your Savior. And that leads us into the next topic, which is Jesus or Muhammad. There's one goal with this thing called life. Eternity is forever. The person you put your trust in will determine where you spend eternity. For there really is a heaven and there really is a hell, and it's the most important choice you will make in your eternity. Dr. Josh McDowell, you know, you had to make that choice. I did. Abdu, you made that choice, and you changed your answer, which is, you know, they say don't do that on a test. But
I changed my answer. That's right.
You changed
that's
your right. answer, which
it's
is
like God gave us erasers.
Amen. Amen. So we have all three here, and I just want, Josh, would you address that question of why you feel Jesus is the only way, the only truth, and the only life, and the only way to heaven?
Well, apart from all the evidence on the resurrection, prophecy fulfilling his life, miracles and everything, is a theological issue. Man had a problem, or God had a problem, humanly speaking. The Bible seems to indicate he created us not because he had to, but he desired to, because he wanted a relationship with his creation. And starting with Adam, sin entered the human race. Now, I could get upset with Adam saying, why am I responsible for that? But look, if Adam hadn't done it then, I would have done it now. And I've confirmed his decision to turn from God 1,000 times over in my life. And so I can't blame God for that. So sin entered. Now, you have to understand, God is not just a God of love, etc. He's a holy, just, righteous God. And so here he created us to share his love with us. So God, he approached man with his love to save us. But because he's not only love, but he's also holy, just, righteous, then his very nature had to destroy us. And so God had a predicament. He would approach us with his love to save us. His very nature had to destroy us. We had a predicament. We fell into sin. I've never met a person that I couldn't look at them and say, you are a sinner. No matter how good of a life they try to live, we cannot live up to God's nature and his laws. And to break them means you are a sinner. And I think we're born with that nature. And so we would approach God for salvation because he's the only one that could save us. And we'd approach us with his love for salvation. But here again, because he's not just a God of love, he's a holy, just, righteous God, his very nature had to destroy us. So we had a predicament. How did God resolve it? He resolved it this way. In the God nature of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, a decision was made that God the Son would take on human flesh. He would become the God-man. I put it this way. He became just as much man as if he'd never been God, and just as much God as if he'd never been man. And because he was not only the God-man and man, but God, he had the infinite capacity to take the sins of the world upon himself, which the Bible says he did, that he bore all of our sins. And when Jesus went to the cross, when he said, it is finished, do you realize that what happened there was God not only expressed his love upon his son, but he also expressed his holy, just, righteous nature upon his son and our sins. And when Jesus said it is finished, the whole just, righteous nature of God was satisfied, or as the New Testament says, propitiated. And what does that mean? It means this. Then God was set free to approach us with his love and not have to destroy us, because his holy, just, righteous nature was satisfied. God couldn't set aside his nature. God cannot exercise one attribute to the preclusion of another. And so therefore, on the cross, the predicament was resolved. And this is why I know no other man in history, not Buddha, not Muhammad, not Confucius, anyone, or Obama, that ever you know, could do that or
Amen.
Did that.
Amen.
And so I have a confidence, apart from all the evidence, that theologically Christ is the one who propitiated the holy, just, righteous nature of God.
Amen.
So this is why Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one cometh unto the Father. Why? Because no one else died for all the sins of the world. No one else propitiated the holy, just, righteous nature of God. Wow.
Amen.
That's the kind of Savior I want to love and serve.
You know, I've been blessed to travel around the world, and just recently I was in Haiti, and it was miles upon miles of people living in conditions with four poles in the ground and a tarp over them. These people have lacked clean water and any decent meals or nutrients or food in God knows how long. They looked on the street like the walking dead. And we did an open-air crusade where we invited tens of thousands to come. You know what happened? We proclaimed the name of Jesus. We proclaimed the name of Jesus. What I saw was a mass of people who had materially nothing, no homes, no water, no luxuries, no food, no anything, whose arms were raised and tears of joy flowing down their cheeks, completely at peace, and looked happy beyond what anything on this earth can give you because they had Jesus. We saw bodies that were sick get healed. We saw people that were lost get saved. We saw people emotionally and mentally depressed become renewed and become whole and become healed. And I got to tell you, had we done that same event and proclaimed the name of Muhammad or Buddha or Confucius or Obama or any of those other people or Josh or Abdul or Assad, absolutely nothing would have happened. Brother Abdul, would you address?
Please. But you know what's beautiful there? You proclaim the name of Christ. They came to Christ. But also realize in the scriptures, you and me, Abdul, believers, are also called to step in and meet their needs.
Amen.
To meet their needs for food and clothing and housing.
Amen.
And that's what the body of Christ is doing.
That's right.
And so God is not just concerned about our soul.
Amen.
He's concerned about our body, about our life, about our mind, about our heart. In other words, God is concerned about every aspect of our life.
Praise God.
That's
Amen.
Right.
That's
right.
Why I picked that one. I'll do Muhammad. Does he fall short in any of these areas?
Well, I was going to actually address it in some of the similar ways that Josh did as well. Some of the things that speak to me as to why Jesus is the only way. Someone once asked me in a debate to answer the question, why are you not a Muslim? And the answer I gave was a silly one, but it's actually profound if you think about it. It was because I'm a Christian. I'm not a Muslim because I'm a Christian. But why am I a Christian? I'm a Christian because Jesus is the only way. He's the only way for all the reasons that Josh said. In fact, there's a commonality between Christianity and Islam in this sense. In Surah 35:45, the Quran says that if God were to judge man for his sin, he would leave nothing on the earth. Interesting, isn't it? That if God judged humanity for its sin, he would leave nothing on the earth. Why not? Why kill the lions? Why destroy trees? Because man's sin taints creation. And it groans until he returns. And so that is the predicament Josh just talked about. That's a commonality we have in seeing that. And so if we realize that, and no one needs evidence for that beyond turning on the news for a half an hour and knowing that man is woefully sick and needs a savior, no other worldview tells you that in the stark reality that Jesus tells it to you. Because no worldview tells you that you need a savior that way and provides one for you. The Bible also tells us, as Josh was just talking about, that God is maximally just and maximally holy and maximally loving. So he needs to solve this predicament of how do I maintain perfect justice and perfect love at the same time, and the cross provides that. In fact, our Muslim friends believe something very, very profound. They believe Allahu Akbar, God is greater. That is profound. It's important that we know this because they believe that God is greater than anything you can conceive of. So if you can think of a being that's greater than the God you have, that being would be God. So if he's the greatest possible being, then he must be able to express himself in the greatest possible way. And so if he is the greatest possible judge and must be absolute in his judgment. He is the greatest possible lover, and so he must love you in an absolute way. And how does he do both without compromising either? The cross does that. But more than that, the reason why I find such truth in distinction to every other worldview, and anyone who denies the Trinitarian nature of God, is that God in the Trinity exists as Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one God, three persons. He is not dependent upon his creation to love. Because If he is absolutely one, he is one in nature and one in person, but he is al-wadud, as the Quran says, as if he is loving, and some Muslims would say that's more than loving, then who does he love when there's no creation? He's dependent upon us to express a fundamental attribute of himself. But in Christianity, he exists as a being in relationship. The Father loves the Son. The Son loves the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit loves the Father and the Son. He exists that way. He does not need us, which makes his act of creation even better. He creates us without any need to do so. And that is the greatest possible being. He does not depend upon us. He depends only upon himself. And the last thing I'm going to say about this is that, what is the greatest possible ethic? The greatest ethic is love. Al-Wadud is one of his fundamental natures, fundamental parts of his nature, I should say. And if the fundamental part of his nature is love, then God is capable of loving in the best possible way. What is the greatest way to love? It's the self-sacrifice. It's to give of yourself. Everybody listening to this show and watching this show knows this, that the greatest way you show love to someone is to give of yourself. Otherwise, you don't really know if someone loves you. You don't really know that. You have a suspicion, but until they're willing to be uncomfortable in their love, you don't know it. God, in his essence, incarnates himself in Christ and gives of himself for you. If you and I are capable of loving someone in a greater way than God, then that God isn't the greatest possible God. But God shows his love for us in this, the Bible says, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. That means that he didn't die for those who love him. He died for those who hate him. And that is the greatest possible love.
And this is what makes Christianity so unique. See, anyone can love the lovable. Mm-hmm. Non-believers, believers, whatever, Hindus, Muslims, Buddhists, everyone can love the lovable. But as a Christian, I am commanded and empowered to love the unlovable. Wow. Love your enemies. Love those who do harm unto you. That, to me, when that is lived out, is one of the greatest testimonies of Christ's power in a person's life.
Amen. Amen.